Good morning.
Good morning.
I don't know about you, but I had a great time last night. A lot of fun. So today I'm going to be speaking to you about Egyptian religion. And Egyptian religion is an extremely fascinating topic, especially when you put it in the context of the overall ancient Egyptian religion. Because it's really important to stress the fact that religion is the basis of this culture. You really cannot separate religion away from really any aspect of this culture. And in fact, many people would say that there is very little secular in this culture, which is a very odd sort of thing. So for example, architecture, pyramids, of course, or tombs, other tombs, this is in the Valley of the Kings, Tomb of Ramses VI, spectacular thing. The temples, of course, as we'll see, these are houses for the gods, that's the reason they're being built. Statuary is not being carved for purely aesthetic purposes, but as we'll see, it has a very defined role in religion. Other sorts, here's a sculpture of King Thutmose III, the king, with these images of the king, are again an aspect of religion because the king is a semi-divine ruler of Egypt, so again, has a religious function. Hieroglyphs, the writing system. In ancient Egypt, the writing system was called the Medjet Netcher, which means words of the gods. So even the writing system was thought to be bestowed upon people by the gods. Mummification, of course, one of the best known aspects of ancient Egyptian culture, is, of course, entirely religious in nature, a way of preserving the memory of the deceased. So all of these aspects, features of the culture, are reflections of beliefs. Now, a few major characteristics of ancient Egyptian religion, and this is where it gets kind of odd. There is no set doctrine. There is no set liturgy. There is no uniform set of teachings. There is no Bible, the equivalent of no Bible, no Torah, no Quran. There is a tremendous amount of variation geographically, a lot of variation chronologically, which can make it, depending on how you feel about it, very confusing or very exciting. It's also important that this religious system lasted for over 3,000 years, one of the longest lasting theologies. But this leads to tremendous complexity because with ancient Egyptian thought and religion, the earliest aspects of religion were retained. And this religion developed over the 3,000 years, but the newer aspects of religion were layered on the old ones. So you have this growing complexity. And the Egyptians did not see this as contradictory. They did not see this as a problem. It was sort of enriching the theology. Now, for the Western mind, we would say, well, you can't have six different theories of the creation of the world. But the Egyptians, all of these coexisted peacefully without any sense of contradiction. So it's a very different sort of mindset. It's the reason why when the Greeks came into Egypt, they just really did not understand at all what's going on with Egypt. And as a result, because it was such an old and very complicated theology, they just gave the Egyptians a pass and said, these guys are so smart. These guys are so brainy, I can't understand them. And this is where we get this whole idea of Egyptian religion being esoteric. And even today, of course, ancient Egyptian religion appeals to people who want to sort of seek higher knowledge. And they're actually not looking in the right spot. But there is this idea that the Egyptians were so pious and so religious and had a sense of other that we are seeking. Now the gods, the religious system, of course, is polytheistic. It's probably one of the most polytheistic systems ever devised. There was, as Ross mentioned, there was one brief period of either henotheism or monotheism, depending on how you want to slice it and dice it. But there were both gods and goddesses, and very often it's very hard to identify them unless there's a hieroglyphic caption. But the thing that's very evident is most of the gods are represented with human bodies, which is a very interesting thing, including navels, nipples. So there's a sense that the gods are related to humans, but not human. So you have these very characteristic heads, headdresses, things of that sort, that help identify the deity and also set the deity apart from humans. And they usually do these wonderful things where, so that here we have a hawk head of the god Ray or Horus or Ray Horaki. And so they wear these big wigs, which then sort of disguises this juncture of the divine and the human. And as I mentioned, sometimes it's very, very hard to identify which god is which unless you can read hieroglyphs. So don't worry about it. For example, a woman with horns on her head could be Isis, Hathor, Uasis, a bunch of different deities. Now, generally, the gods in ancient Egypt were very friendly and helpful. And this is something quite different than, for example, Mesopotamia, Ross was alluding to, where probably one doesn't need too much of a geographic determinism person, but the environment in Mesopotamia is very, very different than in Egypt. In Egypt, the environment is very, very regular. This idea of the huge solar religion because of the brightness of that environment, the regularity of the rising of the Nile each year, so there's a sort of comfort and patterns. Anything that repeating tends to be comforting to people, but people don't like our surprises. And so the Egyptian gods tend to be very benevolent, as opposed to Mesopotamian gods, who could be very, very threatening. So in ancient Egypt, people would come to the gods for help. For example, this is a piece from our collection in the Oriental Institute. It's about the size of a cell phone, and it's made out of stone, and you can see it has human ears on it. These are the ears of the god. So if you wanted something, and in fact, most of Egyptian religion has to do with people offering things to the gods, asking them for stuff, for health, for help, things like this. So if you had a problem, you could say your prayers into the ears of the god, and the god would supposedly help you. And this is portable. As I said, it's almost like the size of a cell phone. So this is something you could just carry around with you. If you need help, you just talk to the god. But this is a good example of how approachable the Egyptians thought that their deities were. As I mentioned, most religious ritual involves offering to the gods because they're believed to have this offering to the gods, partially because the gods were thought to have the same needs as humans. In other words, the gods, because they're shown partially in human form, they needed food, they needed drink, they needed clothing, they wanted new jewelry, all these sorts of things. And a major aspect of the play out of Egyptian religion in the culture, of course, is serving the gods. So here we have one of the houses of the gods. This is Medinet Habu, which is the site that University of Chicago has worked at since 1924. These enormous structures were built, they're called huts in ancient Egyptian, which means house of the god. So each of these enormous temples, the function of this was to provide an abode for a particular deity. So other examples. Here, a reconstruction of the interior of the Luxor temple. Now in the interior, the deepest, darkest interior of these temples was the sanctuary. This was the bedroom of the god. So each of these temples has a sanctuary, and as you can see, there is a particular structure. It's called the naos, with a pyramid on top. This is the benben. These pyramids, or benbens, are thought to be evocative of the place of creation. Now inside this naos is going to be a statue of the god. That's the god who resided in the temple. We have almost none of these statues left. They were of various sizes, of very precious metals. We have lots of texts that talk about kings commissioning new statues to reside in the temple, and they're made out of fabulous metals and the most wonderful imported woods. So many of these were composite statues made of jasper and wood and ebony and ivory and gold. This one is in the Miho Museum in Japan, and it is spectacular. It is silver, because the gods were, according to the text, thought to have bones of silver and skin of gold, so there's gold on it also. Their eyes were thought to be of lapis lazuli, so these incredible images of the gods. So this is probably one of these statues that lived in the deepest, darkest sanctuary. In fact, in ancient Egyptian, the sanctuary is called the Jezer Jezeru, which means the Holy of Holies. This is the bedroom of the god. So these temples that dot the landscape, here's the Karnak Temple that we'll be visiting in Luxor. These structures are, of course, thousands and thousands of years old, very well preserved. But it's important to remember, the reason these are being built is to honor the god. So this is the home of one of the forms of the god Amun, the great state god. And here, the Luxor Temple that we'll also be visiting is also for the god Amun. There are a lot of different forms of Amun, so he's all over the place. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Amun temples. But these are the bedroom of the god and the reliefs on the walls and all the courtyards are related to the service of the god, serving the god. So most of the scenes, first of all, with these, this is an aerial reconstruction of Luxor. And these temples are all also related to each other because the god resided in the bedroom, in the sanctuary, the temple. But the gods like to get out. They don't want to be in the dark sanctuary all the time. And so when the god leaves the sanctuary, we'll see these wonderful scenes where the statue of the god is placed on a boat, because in Egypt you travel by the Nile, by boat. So the statue is placed in a shrine on a boat, and the boat is placed on a series of carrying poles, which are then supported on the shoulders of priests. So you have these double files of priests supporting this boat, which then leaves the temple, and it can go around the temple, where people have a chance to consult the god as an oracle. But the god also likes to go on festivals. And so what we have at Luxor is the Karnak Temple here, which is the abode of Amun of Karnak. And it's connected to, here's the Mut Temple, and here's the Luxor Temple, which is called the Southern Ipet, or the Southern Residence of Amun. So this north is to the right here. And so the statue of Amun, at least every 10 days, leaves this temple and goes down this big processional way, which we'll see, it's just recently been excavated, for better or worse, which is lined with hundreds and hundreds of sphinx statues. And they're actually called cryosphinx. These are ram-headed sphinxes because the image of the god Amun, one of the images is a ram. And so you're just going to be amazed when you see this, how much effort goes into supporting the god Amun. So he often goes between these two temples, and then every 10 days he goes from the Karnak Temple over to the West Bank being the land of the dying sun, so it's mainly mortuary, but it's not cut and dry. And so the statue of the god in the boat goes across the Nile, visits also Deir el-Bahri. A couple people I've been talking to are really looking forward to seeing the Temple of Hatshepsut. That temple is also tied into this whole processional way. And so the god is circulating around town and also between cities. So the scene you most often see on the walls of these temples are scenes of the king offering food, clothing, jewelry, whatever, to the god. Now this is at the Khonsu Temple, which is part of the Karnak Temple. Khonsu is the child of Amun. So just like the gods are shown slightly in human form, they're arranged in families. For example, Amun, the god Amun is married to the goddess Mut, and their son is Khonsu, the moon god shown here. So this is Ramses IV presenting a big tray of food to the god Khonsu, and here are trussed cattle, also part of this offering. So this is the scene you see, because what goes on in these temples is three times a day an imitation of breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The highest priest, acting on behalf of the king, goes into the sanctuary, the bedroom of the god, after purification procedures, opens the shrine, all sorts of prayers, purifications, and then takes the statue of the god out, puts it on a mound of clean sand, undresses it, cleans it, perfumes it, puts new clothing on it, and then gives it food, and then puts it back in the sanctuary, closes the door, and then backs out of the sanctuary. I mean, this sounds like Hollywood, right? It's really cool. The Egyptians, you know, that's why Hollywood loves Egypt. The priest then backs out of the sanctuary with a broom, sweeping his footprints away. So this happens three times a day in every temple in Egypt, which means that these temples are enormous consumers. These temples own thousands and thousands of acres of land all over Egypt, where they're growing the crops, raising the flocks that are used as offerings in these temples. So the temples are really the big economic engines of Egypt also. By the New Kingdom, by about 1000 BC, in fact, Egypt starts having economic problems because the temples own so much land, and, sounds familiar, those lands are usually tax exempt. So the state was no longer receiving taxes from those temple-owned lands. So we have a big period of inflation and problems. But again, it's so interesting how the economy is so tied in to the temples. Now what happens in these temples is the food that's presented to the god, it's called Jebet Hepetu, and that is called reversion offering. So with food is offered to the god, and sometimes it's hundreds and hundreds of loaves of bread, several times a day. So a little sample of the food is laid before the god, and when the god is done with it, we don't know what that interval is, the food is taken away and it's distributed among the priests as their payment. So that's how they pay the priests. So it's a very simple, very clever system. So it's called reversion of offerings. It's placed before the god, comes from the god's lands, goes to the god, and then it goes back to the temple priests and priestesses. Now, animal cults are also a big deal in ancient Egypt. This is the god Anubis, also called Bekwawet, he who is in the wrappings, because he's associated with the necropolis and with mummies, so he who is in the mummy wrappings. This is from the tomb of Nofertari. And from about 1000 BC, we start seeing these animal cults arising. Now, from the very beginning of Egyptian religion, there are, of course, gods with animal heads. And then there are animals associated with certain gods. For example, I said the ram is associated with the god Amun. And often there are a number of different animals associated with a particular god. For example, the god of writing, Thoth, is usually an ibis, but it also can be a monkey, various gods like that. By about 1000 BC, we start seeing this rise of these animal cults in which the temple, for example, if it is a temple to the god Anubis, the priests in that temple are starting to raise jackals. Actually, a better example, let me back up. For example, temple devoted to the god Thoth, the god of writing, they will start raising birds, ibises primarily. So they raise the ibises. You see all this with cat mummies, dog mummies. They mummified basically every animal in ancient Egypt because that animal was related to the god of that temple. So they raise the animals. In the case of the cats, they start in about 3 or 4 months. The kittens, they break their necks. So they're breeding colonies. Then they mummify the animal. And then as a sign of piety, this gets pretty weird. So people come to the temple, and to show their piousness, their devotion to the deity, they buy the mummified animal, and then they give it back to the priests, and the animals are then placed in catacombs. So it's like cats, in fact, going to catacombs. This was enormous business. So a temple, here's Thoth, the god of writing, to whom ibises would be sacrificed. And this was big business. There are animal catacombs all over Egypt. One of the Falcon catacombs near Cairo is estimated to have between 2 and 4 million bird mummies in it. This is a bird mummy from our collection from Abydos, from the southern part of the country. This is not a particularly nicely done one, but it's a wrapped bird mummy in a little clay coffin. And here is a scene from the Egypt Exploration Society. This is an ibis catacomb from the northern part of the country. So each of these pots has a mummified ibis in it. So this was an enormous part of the cult from about 1000 into the Greco-Roman period. This is another reason when the Greeks and Romans get to Egypt, they just scratch their heads and, like, you know, they couldn't figure out what was going on. Some of these animals are very beautifully wrapped. For example, here from the Brooklyn Museum, one for Thoth. And here another example with actually a little head of an ibis on it. Now, death and mummification, of course, is another major part of Egyptian religion. There is a tremendous amount of emphasis placed on mummification in ancient Egypt. And this is not because the ancient Egyptians looked forward to death. They equated death with darkness and sadness. There are a lot of texts talking about how sad it is and people missing their husbands or their wives. Here is a stela in our collection, actually loaned from the Oriental, from the Art Institute, which shows the scene of a funeral. Here is a mummy standing upright, and here is his widow crying at his feet and beating her head in grief. So there's a lot of equation of death with darkness, with sadness, with separation. So the Egyptians' reaction to this was to make death into something else that they could deal with. And so you have this very, very well articulated sense of life after death. This whole idea being that death is one of the great mysteries. all cultures, every culture wrestles with this. What happens after death? Because people don't know, it's frightening. It's one of the greatest terrors in any culture. So the Egyptians developed this idea of life after death patterned on what they knew to make death less frightening. So when you die, if you're a good person, you're reborn into essentially a parallel universe. So you'll be doing the same things you did during your life after your death. And so this is a way of creating an understanding of one of the greatest mysteries. So they try to transcend death by making it life after death. So as I said, it's a mirror image of the life you lived. For example, here's a man named Neb-Amun, shown in the afterlife hunting in the marshes with his wife and his daughter. Wonderful scene from about 1400 BC. But this rebirth was dependent upon certain material features, because the soul in the afterlife was thought to have the same needs as it had when alive. So for example, you had to provide the deceased with food. Food could be supplied in the form of actual food that was left in the tomb, or food could be supplied as an image on the wall, or you could even leave fake food, because you can leave real bread, which will eventually decay. And so we have examples of stone loaves of bread that were left in the tomb because they were there in perpetuity. And so we have scenes like this. So these two people are dead. We know that because the text after them calls them Ma'akeru, or true, or voice. True of voice refers to, we'll talk about this in just a minute, the judgment of the deceased. Your soul, your being goes before the judges, you're judged. You have to say what is called the negative confession. And it says, I have not stolen, I have not lied, I have not blasphemed, I have not, this long list of things. And if the judges accept that, then you are deemed to be ma'akeru, true of voice. You have not lied before the judges, the 42 judges who judge you. This idea of life after death being so much like the life you live carries over also into the terminology and the architecture of tombs. Tombs were called perjets, houses of eternity. And the earliest tombs are actually house models. Some of them actually have lavatories. They're arranged in classic necropolis, so straight streets, and the tombs all through them. And largely these were places not of sorrow. They were places of commemoration and immortalization of the deceased. We have texts that talk about encouraging people to come to the tombs. As we'll see, the tombs are actually composed of two different parts. The body, the mummy, is buried underground in an inaccessible burial chamber. But then there's like the house model at the surface where people can come and leave food, leave supplies, look at the pictures of the deceased, and remember what a nice person this was. And so there are texts that encourage people to come to the necropolis. We have graffiti, ancient graffiti on the tombs. It says, this is such a great place. I don't know who built this, but it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of kind of tourism, tomb tourism in various periods. So these tombs, because they were thought to be repositories for things that the deceased needed, became virtual storehouses. For example, a tomb that we will see, this is a photograph of the tomb of King Tutankhamun as it was discovered in 1922. Here, just jammed with thousands and thousands and thousands of objects that the king was thought to need in the afterlife, including all of these little white cases. These are so-called victual mummies. These are haunches of beef, mummified birds, different types of food, mummified so they'd last forever, so that the king would have food forever. So this was also, just like I was talking about the temples being a major part of the economy, the funerary aspect was also a major, major consumer of the economy. And people who study ancient economics, this is very odd to them, because basically you're burying assets. You're taking all of this stuff out of circulation. But it was still an economic driver of the economy. And people, if you were from a well-to-do family, you had a very fancy tomb. If you were a very modest background, you had a very, very simple tomb. But we think the theology behind this is the same, because the texts talk about it is not your wealth and your riches that will get you into the afterlife, it's your deeds and your character. So rich and poor were judged together. and to be equal. So you had to be remembered. So the 2 minutes furnishings, one of the most characteristic features is the name of the deceased is going to be on the tomb, it is going to be on the objects. For example, these objects from Tutankhamun, his name is all over this, because a very important feature is as long as you are remembered by the living, you're not actually dead. It's sort of gone but not forgotten. It's exactly the same theology. So as long as your name remains upon earth and in the memory of the living, you're not gone. You're just away. You're just away. But you can be contacted and you're remembered and commemorated. So one of the important features of this is the body had to be preserved, because they thought life after death, the spirit is going to need the body, which is why they mummify. They want to make sure that body is preserved. And so this is the god Osiris in the middle. Here he's being a pot of incense is being presented to him. This is a little flame coming out of the pot of incense. This is Seti the first. God Osiris usually has a green face as a sign of vegetation, the power of vegetation to regenerate. So when you die, if you're judged to be pure, true of voice, you become a form of the god Osiris. You actually become you become deified as a form of Osiris. For example, you keep your own personality. So for example, I would be the Osiris Emily. It doesn't matter if you're male or female, you become a form of the god Osiris, which is why you see this odd false beard on statues and coffins, because that's a symbol of your unification or association with the god Osiris. Now in this theology, it's very interesting because Osiris was thought to be the first king of Egypt. The myths of Osiris are very interesting. According to this myth, he was murdered by his evil son, his evil brother Seth, and his body was cut up into pieces and scattered throughout the land. His loyal wife Isis, you've all heard of, this is the real Isis, not the bad Isis. It's like Egyptologists are not happy that they appropriated the word Isis. This is really inappropriate. So lovely Isis travels all through Egypt. She's mourning, she's crying and screaming out of woe that her husband has been murdered. She goes through Egypt, collects all the parts of his body, it's usually 42 parts, and brings them back together, reassembles them, wraps them in linen to reunify the body. And this is where you get the idea of mummification. You're reuniting the body, you're creating a mummy, and through that process, the person will be rejuvenated. Now, in the case of Isis and Osiris, it's particularly poignant because one of the last parts that Isis finds of her husband is his phallus. And she wraps that with the rest of the body, and he magically comes back to life. And even in death, he impregnates her. There are these wonderful scenes of Isis in the form of a kite, of a hawk, and she's descending upon the erect phallus of her husband, who is mummified, who's dead. She's impregnated, and their son, Horus, is born as posthumous son of the father. And from this, you get this very potent idea that life after death, because even the power of Osiris to engender a son when he's dead is that same power that will enable all of us to be reborn after our death. So it really is a religion of hope. People say, oh, it's all about funerary, but it's about the idea of transcending an end and transcending death. So this idea of making mummies, this is a very unusual one from the Old Kingdom, about 2500 BC. Usually mummies are what they're more classic mummy where there's a big shroud around them. But this is a very, very interesting one. You see, even has a headrest, a pillow. So the process of mummification was very, very complicated. The important thing, of course, is to arrest decomposition of the body. So what you want to do is you want to take all the moisture out of the body. Because in Egypt, it's very hot and dry, so things naturally dry out. They naturally mummify, which is probably where they got this idea. Because they would see, for example, an animal who died in the desert, and it's in the sand, it's going to be naturally preserved. So they remove the stomach, liver, lungs, and intestines through an incision on the left side of the body. I'm sure you guys all remember this from like fifth grade when you're studying ancient Egypt. You say, well, it's an easy process, but it's really not an easy process. It's really pretty grisly. There are special embalmers, professional embalmers, who do this. And they also remove the brain because as a point of moisture, it will cause decomposition, so they remove the brain, usually discard the brain, but the stomach, liver, lungs, and intestines were separately mummified, or at least segments of them were separately mummified, and placed in these jars called canopic jars. The deities are each associated with a particular organ that's inside the jars. This is my kids' love Egypt, you know? It's really got all this great stuff going on. And then these jars are then, with the involved viscera, are put in the tomb with the mummy, because the mummy's going to need this stuff when it's reborn. So very, very simple. So the body was wrapped and placed in a coffin. And very often there are spare parts for the body, because if you're going to be reborn, the Egyptians realized the preservation of the body was paramount, because you need your body. So there were all these fail safes, or all these fallbacks. For example, in the Ptolemaic period and earlier, you think about the tomb of Tutankhamun, that gold mask, I'm sure you've all seen pictures of. That's the same thing as this. That is a spare head. It was placed over the wrapped head and shoulders of the mummy in case something happened with the body. So it's a spare head, because the deceased needed eyes, nose, mouth, and ears for the faculties to function again in the afterlife. Also, the body had to remain recognizable. And so although this is not a portrait of anyone, it would allow the spirit, which we'll talk about in a minute, the spirit to come back to the body, recognize the body, to reunify the body and the soul. So we have spare heads, spare feet, set of spare feet in our collection, placing the sandals. So these would again be placed over the wrapped body. A lot of variations in mummification in the earlier periods. Some bodies were actually turned into statues. They were coated in plaster. Again, this idea of being an immortal representation of the deceased. This is actually a human body that has been encased in plaster. This was a process that was sort of a flash in the pan. It wasn't followed for a long time. But there is this idea of the association of the mummy with a statue. And there are various funerary rituals that are enacted upon statues of the deceased. And so there's this idea of the mummy is can be a statue. And so see, statues are a very important part of immortality. A lot of variation in coffins. This is a classic Old Kingdom, huge granite sarcophagus, which is an architectural representation of a house. These are windows. And so the deceased would be placed in this house of eternity, and this would be then been placed in a larger tomb. In some periods, we even have little doors. In fact, here, this is a door right here, so the soul can come and go out of the tomb. Or here from the Middle Kingdom, about 2000 BC, here we have the eyes to allow the mummy to see out of this little model house. In this period, the mummy was wrapped and placed on its left side, and so the eyes would be opposite this, called an eye panel. And here's a little doorway for the soul to come and go. Again, all of this preparation as a way of ensuring that the deceased would be fine in the afterlife. And the classic sort of New Kingdom coffin, this is from our excavations at Luxor. And during this period, those who could afford it would have a whole series of coffins. This is a set of nested coffins, so the outer coffin, middle coffin, and the inner coffin. This inner coffin is made out of a substance like paper mache, it's called cartonnage. So again, people expressed their economic standing by how elaborate their tombs and mummification procedures were. And then later period, these enormous basalt or granite sarcophagi, again, various styles and different periods with funerary text. Here's the mummy lying on a bed with the four canopic jars under the bed, various deities ensuring rebirth, and again, this idea of architecture. So the body is put in a representation of a house, but here with more gods. And then by 26th dynasty, about the year 600 BC, we have these very interesting big coffins, primarily from the northern part of the country. So a lot of variation. So as Egyptologists, part of what we do is we can date this material stylistically, because 3,000 years is a lot of change in taste in ancient Egypt, from pottery to clothing to coffins to all the rest of it. So what happened to the soul after death? And this is a Roman period mummy. Very, very interesting, because during this period, instead of doing an extra head, like a helmet over the head and shoulders, they actually do a portrait of the deceased. And when I talk about art this afternoon, you'll see how very different this is. When Greeks and Romans came into Egypt, they were so beguiled by this funerary religion, because the Greeks, at least, had a very poorly articulated sense of what happens after death, and it's pretty grim. The spirit lives as shadows, the river Styx, it's not very hopeful, it's not well thought out. So they come to Egypt and they go, wow, this is kind of cool. They figure this all out, and so Greeks and Romans, a lot of them adopt Egyptian funerary processes, which is sort of odd. But here, because the Roman artistic tradition is actually one of portraiture, Egyptian artists do not do portraiture, and I'll talk about this, I'll tell you why later. But so what they're doing is putting an actual portrait of the deceased wrapped onto the coffin. They're really very beautiful portraits. So what happens to the soul of the deceased after death? As I mentioned, after death, the soul is judged by gods to see if the individual is worthy of being reborn and becoming associated with the god Osiris. So the main scene we see, this is from chapter 125, the Book of the Dead. The Book of the Dead is a whole series of religious texts that are kind of like cliff notes to the afterlife. They're protective, they tell you what's going to go on, because the Egyptians believe that knowledge is power. As long as you know what's going to go on, you're okay. And of course, part of this is reducing the anxiety level and the terror level, because if you know what's going to go on, if you're prepared, then it's not as horrible. So this is a classic scene which shows the deceased and his wife. The guy's name is Ani, and his wife, he's dead. And here we have the gods, and there's a balanced scale here. And this little pot is a representation of the human heart. The Egyptians believe that the heart was the seat of the soul and of consciousness and of emotion. For example, in ancient Egyptian, if you want to say a man is happy, you say he's wide of heart. Or he's heavy of heart if he's sad. So emotions are couched in reference to the heart. So the heart is placed, in a balanced scale. Opposite, Ross mentioned the goddess Ma'at, the goddess of truth, harmony, balance, fairness. And so we have the god Anubis, that god of embalming, Imiut, who is in the wrappings, weighing the soul against truth. And if the balance scale is even, it means that this person who has already recited the negative confession, these are the gods up here, some of them, will then be allowed to proceed to the god Osiris, where he will be reborn and he will be renamed Ani Osiris. But if you don't pass, and we don't have any examples where people didn't pass, because of course they didn't want to, you know, preserve that. If you don't pass, and the gods do not accept the confession, you are lying. And there are lots of texts that talk about, do not, heart of my mother, do not testify against me before the judges. So there are lots of these texts about, don't turn against me, soul. So, but if that happens, the heart, this is really scary to the Egyptians, the heart is taken and given to this horrible creature. It's called Amit, the devourer. And in typical Egyptian terror sort of scenes, you can see it's not a real animal, it's a composite of a hippopotamus, a lion, and other animals, which to the Egyptians is really, really scary. For them, the gods that have a human body and an animal head, that's fine. They understand that. But when you start combining things completely against nature, to them, that is terrifying. So anything against nature is scary. For example, if your heart is thrown to the devourer, poof, you no longer exist. And non-existence is the worst thing to the ancient Egyptians, because then you'll be forgotten by the living. You have no afterlife. The Egyptians considered hell to be a place of unnaturalness. Time goes backward. People are upside down. They eat filth. The air is full of the screaming of cats. For some reason, the Egyptians thought that was really scary, screaming of cats. That's a wonderful, vivid image of what hell was about. But so, if you're a good person, you proceed to association with the god Osiris, again shown here with the characteristic green face, and you go on to live forever in a lovely, happy afterlife. And usually the deceased, different in certain periods, but here you can see this person beautiful coffin, and here the beard, the false beard of the god Osiris, which is an indication that he is a form of Osiris. In fact, the personal name, which is on the coffin, will call that person again the Osiris personal name. Now, the personality and soul of the deceased and living people was composed of several different aspects, and I'm only going to talk about a couple of them. One is called the Ka, K-A, and this is almost like the spiritual double, the physical being of the individual. This is a Ka statue, spectacular statue in Cairo, of a king who lived about roughly 2000 BC. You can see he's got hands on top of his head. You can see his arms raised up like this. See the little hands up here? That's the hieroglyphic spelling for the word Ka, for the spirit. So you know that this is a Ka statue. It is the Ka that needs food in the afterlife. Funerary offering formulas say, may you have 1,000 of bread, beer, oxen, and fowl for the Ka of the deceased so-and-so. So the Ka is the one that needs to actually eat. But another aspect, which is really lovely, is called the Ba, B-A. The Ba is shown as a human-headed bird. And this is a really lovely part of the theology, because the Egyptians believed that the Ba stayed with the deceased. The Egyptians live in a very sunlit environment. They don't like darkness. But of course, the mummy is sealed in an underground burial chamber, so they want to alleviate that. So the way they figured this out is the Ba, every morning when the sun comes up, this aspect of the soul of the individual leaves the mummy, flies up through the blocked burial chamber, out through the tomb, and sits in the trees. Here, shown in the tomb of Userhat, here we have the dead Userhat and his wife, and here are their baas, and you see human-headed birds. And according to this theology, that each morning, the bird, the ba, comes out of the tomb, sits in the trees. They're sitting on a little T-shaped pool, by the way, it's water. So they drink the cool water, they eat, they chirp away. And so in ancient Egypt, which is, by the way, on the major flyways, the migration patterns for all the birds from Europe to Africa, so it's a big bird area. So they look at these birds and think, oh, you know, it's my ancestors. In other periods, again, there's a lot of hopefulness in this. In earlier periods, they believed that when you died, you went up and became a star. So when we're in Egypt at night, when you look up and see those heavens that are just completely full of stars, again, this idea, this hopefulness. You're not cut off from communication with your deceased relatives and friends. So then when night, when dusk came, this Ba had to return to the tomb. It had to go back into the tomb. It flew back down through the burial chamber. It has to recognize the mummy, which is why they need the extra heads. They want to make sure the mummy is well preserved, because the Ba has to recognize its own body. And then we have these wonderful scenes of the Ba coming down and alighting on the chest of the mummy, stretching its wings out to embrace the mummy. And there it spends the night. Till the next morning, it leaves the tomb, and this whole cycle. Yet the Egyptians are very much into cycles because they're comforting. It's like, you know what's going to happen. It's predictable. It's regulated. So we see a lot of cyclic patterns in ancient Egypt. Now, the nature of the world of the dead, it was very interesting. It was a liminal space. The Egyptians had the idea of the barrier between life and death was a little permeable, you might say. So, for example, this is from our collection. This is a letter to the dead. You can communicate with dead people by writing to them. The power of writing was so potent that you could, if you wanted something, for example, this is a letter from a man to his deceased, I think it's his deceased grandfather, and he's asking for help. He and his wife want to have another baby, and they're having trouble. And so he's asking for help from the afterlife, because these dead people are called Ox, A-K-H. These Ox can be very, very powerful, and they can help you. They can intercede on your behalf with the gods. So a lot of these say, oh, you know, please, I need some little help here. Sometimes these letters to the dead are really weird. If, for example, there's one very classic one where a man has been ill recently, and he's blaming it on his dead wife. And he writes her a letter, and he says, I took such good care of you. We were very, very happy. You got sick, I took time off work, he says, took time off work to take care of her. He got the best physician, but she died. He spent a huge amount of money having her mummified, beautiful tomb, and this is the thanks I get. He even says, and I have not even taken another wife. And so that, I think there's a sense that you have to be a little careful because the ox, these deceased individuals, if they're not happy, they can be a problem. They become like haunting spirits. So there are ancestor cults where you leave things for the ox to keep them on their side. But this, so these letters to the dead, also people embroiled in law cases, lawsuits. The Egyptians were very litigious. They were constantly suing each other, so they wrote a lot of stuff down. But sometimes these are writing to dead people, asking them to serve as witnesses in trials for them, to testify on their behalf from the afterlife. Now, you couldn't talk to dead people, but you could see them in your dreams. So again, this idea that the Egyptians of many cultures, this idea of sleep, you know, what is sleep? What is this deal with sleep? It's a different realm you enter into. And being in that realm of sleep, you could see what is called the White City. Oddly enough, they called it the White City, which is where the dead people lived. And you could see them. You could not communicate with them. You could not talk to them, but you could see them. So we only have a few texts about that, but it's very interesting, the White City, where the dead live. So what I want to leave you with, really, is the idea that Egyptian religion was largely a religion of hope and helpfulness. It's not a land where the gods were routinely angry and threatening to strike down people. The king was the protector of the people, the semi-divine king, protector of the people, and the intermediary between his subjects and the gods. And in theory, any citizen had access to not only the king, but also the deities. So even if Egyptian religion seems so unfamiliar and maybe sort of confusing and weird, their beliefs provided stability and continuity that allowed the Egyptians to rule the Nile Valley for more than 3,000 years. Thank you very much. Now, I'd be delighted to answer any questions in case you have a question or two about this. Yes?
I was just curious when you talked about preserving the organs of the body, but not the brain.
The question is, why do they keep the stomach, liver, lungs, and intestines, but not the brain? Well, in theory, what you usually read is they didn't understand the function of the brain. As I mentioned, emotions are expressed in terms of the heart, because the brain doesn't make any noise. The heart does, so the heart, of course, is associated with the living being. But, so in theory, it was non-functional, but that's not really true because we have a lot of medical texts that talk about concussions and traumatic injury to the head where they recognize that the brain has a very, very great function. So we don't really know why they're doing it. It doesn't make sense. They also, for example, in theory, you know, is one thing, but in practice, because for example, those canopic jars, they're not big enough for a set of lungs. So what they're doing is they're taking samples. There are a bunch of German Egyptologists who did this macabre thing where they're opening canopic jars and seeing what's actually in them. So they're taking samples of these organs, so it's symbolic. For example, sometimes they leave the kidneys in the body, sometimes they don't leave the kidneys in the body. There's a lot of variation. Sometimes they leave the heart in the body, which in theory they should. Sometimes they take it out and replace it with a model of the heart in the form of a scarab. So there's a lot of variation, both through time and through practices. But a good question. Yeah, in the back.
Recently, you know, in the Great Pyramids in Giza, they have these channels from the burial chamber on out. Is that perhaps the purpose of the rock?
Very good question. In the burial chamber at the Great Pyramid, Khufu, which you've all seen pictures of, there are these channels that go through the masonry and exit at the exterior of the structure. A lot of engineering went into that, so it has a very definite purpose. We think, because we weren't left with a manual of, you know, that particular structure, it probably has to do with that early theology of the soul of the king ascending to the stars. Because from this period, we have a whole series of religious texts called the Pyramid Texts that talks about the soul of the deceased king. It's originally only for kings. and it talks continually about him becoming what is called one of the imperishable stars. These are the stars that never go below the horizon, so you always can see them. And so we think those so-called light shafts or air shafts are probably symbolically the soul of the king to like shoot out of the pyramid and ascend to the stars.
What happened to the peasants and the slaves?
What happens to modest peasants and slaves? As I mentioned, first of all, a big problem is the lower income, like the farmers. Egypt was an agrarian society, so the huge percentage of the population were farmers. We don't know what percentage, because the problem is, if you don't have the means to leave a tomb and coffins and all that sort of stuff, archaeologically you disappear. So everything I've been talking about is based on material remains that are documenting, we don't know, maybe the top 15% of the population, the top 20%, because we don't really know. But we do have very simple burials. For example, just a hole in the desert and the body. And so a very low-level tomb would have the body, maybe not mummified, but would be naturally mummified by being in contact with the sand. And there'd be maybe a couple pots that would have contained food, maybe a crummy little statue. So you can see the de-escalation of the complexity of these burials, which are, of course, in concert with that person's socioeconomic class. But people were clearly putting a lot of money aside for these funerals. For example, you started building your tomb as soon as you like got a job. So you start building your tomb during your lifetime, because people are talking about going and overseeing it and buying stuff and adding to it and encouraging their friends to come look at it. Now, I'm glad you brought up slaves, because slaves are not a big part of Egyptian society, which is a big surprise to most people. And this comes from the biblical tradition of the enslavement of the Hebrews by the Egyptians. There were slaves in Egypt. Many of them were prisoners of war. But slaves, as in most different cultures, there were different types of slaves. Some slaves could actually earn money. But slaves are not a major part of the Egyptian economy or society. People assume they're major. For example, the pyramids were built by free labor. These are major, major construction projects, and the kings are not letting anybody but professionals work on those projects. And so the building of the pyramids, again, the economic implication of this is astounding, because you're employing maybe 10,000 men. It may be less than that. We keep on downgrading the number of men. Those men have to be housed, fed, water has to be brought to them. Their job is to build pyramids. And so you've got this enormous support staff. So again, huge economic resources going into this. But slaves are not being used on those projects, because this is, it's been likened actually to a WPA project. These are enormous civic projects run by the state, for the state, for the glory of the king. And so these are not slave-based at all. And they're professional. We know a tremendous amount, especially from the slightly later period. The things we're gonna see in Luxor, we know the guys' names who built these things, we know that they're paid, how often they had to turn their copper chisels in to be resharpened. There's so much that's familiar. They had job boxes. You know, the guys would come to work in the morning, because copper was very valuable. It was a means of exchange. They didn't have coinage, but they'd exchange copper. So you come to the job site, you check out your chisel, you go work on the limestone cliffs, you come back up, and you turn it in, you check out another one. So we know all of this. We know like how often they're issued wicks for their lamps to illuminate the work. It's just astounding how much we know, which makes it very frustrating for the things we don't know. There's a lot we don't know. Maybe just one more question? Yes.
Thank you. You've taken my question before, so I appreciate it. Around the pyramids, it seems that quite a few burials of, not slaves perhaps, but occurred. As they started to research more and more, it seems that the higher you were in your society level, the closer you were to the pyramid. Is that correct?
That's a very good comment. Because not just any, you know, Joe Schmo is going to be buried near the king. And so we have a lot of written records from the time of the pyramids that a lot, first of all, those, it's the classic necropolis, as I mentioned, because around the pyramid there are these rows and rows and rows of these little tombs called mastaba tombs. We know that some of those, the locations were given to those individuals by the king. They were in the civil service, they did a good job, and the king said, you're doing a great job, you can build your tomb right there. And there are people that, in their autobiographies, we've got a lot of autobiographical texts which are extremely interesting, talk about, because the king favored me so much, he gave me an enormous double false door for my tomb as a reward for his good service. So that, particularly around the pyramids, that is very closely regulated who can be buried there. And a lot of those tombs, there have been some studies done recently, a lot of them, like one group of tombs, will all belong to men who had the same job. So it's kind of, you get the overseer, the workman, you're buried over there, the scribes get buried over there. So it's very, very closely regulated. And the same thing was in Luxor. In Luxor, we'll see on the West Bank, which is the land of the dying sun, so a lot of the tombs, although there are some tombs on the East Bank. But there, it was very closely regulated. You could only build tombs in certain areas. You had to keep this area completely clear because of processions of the gods. So this is not just willy-nilly. There's a lot of government control over what's going on in ancient Egypt. It makes it really, really fascinating. Well, thank you very much, and I'm always happy to answer one more question.